Okay, so let me resume then my lectures. So to summarize what we learned in the first lecture, so we learned that most of perturbative series are factorially divergent. So typically, the coefficients grow like n factorial e to the minus n. And this leads to non-perturbative. So there are, let's say it in a less committed way, there are typically non-perturbative effects order e to the minus a over the coupling constant z associated to non-trivial saddle points. And sometimes one can make sense of this series by this procedure of resummation, by Borel resummation, say. And when you do this, as I was emphasizing, you don't have to consider only, you not only have to consider the first perturbative series, but you also have to consider the series associated to these non-perturbative effects. And the goal of at the end of the day is to reconstruct the true observable which is behind this, this is series, right? And this cannot always be done. In some cases, you are lucky and you don't even have to include this non-perturbative effect. This is actually important to keep in mind. Sometimes you don't even have to include this. For example, you consider the quartic and harmonic oscillator in quantum mechanics. You just do a Borel resummation of the perturbative series. You get the right energies on the spot. You don't have to do anything else. In some other circumstances, you will have to add explicitly these non-perturbative effects and add on top of the original perturbative series these additional series, which I call trans series, and you also have to do Borel resummation of them. Okay, now, so this is a quite generic story, but what happens in string theory? So how all this story applies to string theory? Well, the discussion I was making this morning assumed that I only have one coupling constant. For example, in the case of the quartic oscillator, I have one coupling constant, which was just the quartic perturbation of the oscillator. Now, the most important aspect of string theory from the point of view of this discussion, and also from other points of view, is that there are actually two coupling constants in string theory. Which govern two different things. One coupling constant is the string length, LS, and the other is the string coupling constant, which I'm going to call GST. And the string length actually measures how this measures quantum fluctuations around the point particle limit. So strings are extended objects, and this string length, when it goes to zero, is this the limit in which you recover a point particle theory. And the string is just what describes describes the strength of the splitting and joining of strings, right? Every time you have a three vertex interaction of a string, this has the weight string. Okay? So these are a priori quite independent quantum parameters in the sense that you can formally at least have a string theory in which you take the string coupling to zero and then you have genus zero string theory, or you can actually consider a theory in which you have G string but you can take LS to zero and this is some sort of supergravity limit plus interactions and so on. So you can in principle play with both of them. And then both of them will lead to different features. In particular, as I mentioned this morning, the most usual and tractable non-perturbative edge are of the form e to the minus a over z. So here, since we have two different coupling constants, the non-perturbative effect in the string length will be of the form minus m, let me call it like this, ls square, well, ls square is also called alpha prime. And then here, we will have another, so this I'm going to call it a wall sheet non-perturbative effect, so typically proportional to an instanton action A wall sheet divided by ls square, and then there will be a non-perturbative effect in space-time, what is called call it a space-time non-perturbative effect, and this is a non-perturbative effect in this coupling constant, and this is typically of this form. I'm not trying to be exhaustive here, probably there are more complicated non-perturbative effects. For example, you can have non-perturbative effects in a string theory which go like e to the minus 1 over g string square. I'm just giving you some of the most important ones and the ones that will appear in the concrete discussion that I will make later. So these two things will appear in a concrete model that I will discuss in these lectures, and this is what I'm discussing them here. But there are other non-perturbative effects in string theory. Now, these effects are actually relatively, these effects which are due to, which are involve the string length, are relatively easy to understand. Because, you see, you can describe very often a string theory by a sigma model with a given target, and actually, these non-perturbative effects are typically due to what are called wall sheet instantons. So you have a map from a Riemann surface of genus G to a given target, and then you have a non-linear sigma model. And then these non-perturbative effects correspond to standard wall sheet instantons in the non-linear sigma model. So you have here a target, and then if the image of your map wraps a non-trivial cycle, the area of this cycle will be given by a quantity called AWS, and this gives a physical interpretation to this quantity in string theory. So typically, this corresponds to the area of a wall sheet instant in a non-linear sigma model. So these are relatively well understood non-perturbative effects in two dimensions. And I have to say here that if the scale of the target is associated, if the length scale of the target is given by a radius L, as happens, for example, in the AdS if the respondent. So this gives me the typical size, the typical length scale of this target manifold X. Then this guy has to be measuring units of length square, and then this exponentially small effect goes like minus L over LS to the square. So actually, weak coupling here, So in this case, weak coupling in this quantum theory describing fluctuations of the string around the point particle limit, weak coupling means that weak coupling is actually the point particle limit. And this is then when the length of the string is very small as compared to the typical scale of the target. Okay. And of course, in this point particle limit, you see that this guy is going to be very suppressed. So non-perturbative effects are in the string length are very suppressed when you have large target scales as compared to the length of the string. Now, these effects are slightly more complicated. It was actually pointed out by Polchinski that the source for these effects are deep brains. So actually, one of the motivations for the introduction of deep brains by Polchinski was actually to be able to account for these non-perturbative effects in string theory. And I have to say that historically, it's very interesting the way that these non-perturbative effects were discovered. Because you can already look at these two equations and see something very interesting. Imagine that I give you a perturbative series, just the series that comes from a perturbative calculation, and I tell you to estimate in some way what are the type of non-perturbative effects that you will find. Well, actually, the general arguments I was telling you this morning tells me that if the coefficients grows like n factorial times a number to the minus n, you should expect the size of a non-perturbative effect to be of this type. Remember that you can see already this with the procedure of optimal truncation. Because in optimal truncation, this growth led to an error in my calculation with optimal truncation, which is exactly of this size. So you can always relate the large order behavior of a perturbative series to the appearance of these exponentially small effects. So, of course, if you have a nice path integral formulation of your theory, you can derive these things also from say, non-trivial saddle points of your theory. But in string theory, we don't have a path integral of the full space of string fields. So it's not so easy to find this by looking at saddle points of a path integral. So actually, in string theory, the way these effects were discovered were in some toy models of string theory in less than one dimension, what are called non-critical strings. People observed that the typical growth of the perturbative series was of this type and deduced the existence of these effects from the growth of perturbation theory. So this is actually what Polchinski noticing already in 94, that if you introduce deep brains, you have a natural source for this type of effects. Now, let me see what we are going to do in this lecture. In this lecture, we are not going to focus on the most general quantity in string theory. We are going to focus on a peculiar quantity. And the reason why we focus on this is because we have a lot of control, analytic control on this quantity. There is no other reason for that. And what we are going to focus is the total partition function or free energy. Of superstring theory on some backgrounds. On backgrounds involving AdS space. But before getting into the details of that, what do you expect for this type of functions? Well, the free energy will depend on two variables. Let me actually call one of these variables lambda for reasons that we will see in a moment, and then G stream. So lambda here should be understood as a function of L over LS. So it could be, for example, L over LS, but in the examples I will use, when there is some duality between AdS backgrounds and gauge theories, lambda will be the top parameter and will be typically a power of this quantity. But it's just a way of encoding the dependence on the coupling constant, on the two coupling constant of string theory. Now, what perturbative string theory tells me is that I can, yes? Oh, sorry. Oh, sure, I will try, but it's hard, huh? It's hard, yeah. Maybe, I don't know if it's easy, no, all these things are filled, so yeah. Okay, I will try my best. So let me start with this equation. Okay. So this is the total free energy, and if you do a calculation of this quantity in perturbative string theory, what do you find? Well, you will have to sum over the free energies of different genera, so weighted by the coupling constant to this power. So this is the typical dependence, and this is the contribution of genus G Riemann surface. So you can think in terms of embedded strings, what do you have? It's just simply that you are calculating, this is a vacuum to vacuum amplitude, is the free energy, so this is the logarithm of the partition function, so you have to do the path integral over all possible string configurations, and we know that the space of string configurations is labeled by the genus, so you will have contributions of genus zero, so you will have spherical strings, then we will have genus one strings, which are donut-like strings, and so on. And for each of these quantities, string perturbation theory tells me a priori there is a path integral over the space of strings with a fixed genus, and then I have to put all these things together with this power GST. Okay? So this is a formal power series like the ones that we have been studying. And now you can ask questions about what are the convergence properties of this power series. And this is a slightly more delicate problem than what we had before. Because before we had a formal power series, but the coefficients were just numbers. Now the coefficients are here functions of lambda. So you have to be very careful about, for example, what kind of function you have here and what kind of function you get when you sum over all these things and so on. Okay. Again, I'm not going to give you a universal answer. I'm going to give you the answer which is relevant for the purposes that I'm doing here. Let's first focus on this quantity. This is a function of lambda, and it turns out that Fg of lambda are essentially analytic functions at lambda equals zero. In many cases, in many examples. And this will be actually much clearer when we look at these functions from the point of view of the AdS-CFT correspondence, because if this string theory has a gauge theory dual, these quantities can be a priori computed in gauge theory by summing over genus G diagrams, over tough diagrams of fixed genus G. And these functions are essentially analytic at lambda equals zero. When I mean essentially, I mean that they can have some leading singularities coming from zero modes, but essentially they are given by a power series function around lambda equals zero, which is analytic. So they are analytic functions, means that they have a finite radius of convergence, a priori, around lambda equals zero. And they have a common domain of analyticity for all genus. That's also a quite non-trivial thing, because you could think that depending on the genus, these functions would be analytic in a different regions. But no, they have a common domain of analyticity. So let's say lambda smaller than lambda star. And in this common region of analyticity, when you evaluate this thing, you get numbers. Now, you can ask, and this is an important question, what happens if you want to go from lambda equals zero to lambda equal to infinity, for example? And this is the famous problem of weak strong interpolation that appears in gauge theories. But notice here that the problem of going from, say, a small lambda to large lambda is completely different from what happened in the divergence series that I was telling you about. Because here you already have to start with an analytic function. Now, the behavior of analytic functions is actually much more under control, because analytic functions typically have, for example, analytic continuations to larger regions in their space domain. This is actually what we did this morning with the Borel transform. The Borel transform was analytic in a neighborhood of the origin, and then we were using some principle of analytic continuation in order to be able to calculate this Laplace transform. So these functions, eventually, you can ask the problem of what is going to happen if you try to go to large lambda, and this is the problem of a strong weak interpolation, but you are in the domain of holomorphic functions. So at least of meromorphic functions or functions with branch cut, but at least functions which are holomorphic in a neighborhood of the origin. So this is a completely different problem. Okay, so now once we fix lambda, so we fix lambda inside this domain, we will have now a numerical series, in which you can now ask for this fixed lambda. So now we have here numbers. Now you give me a lambda inside this domain of analyticity, and you ask me, well, how these numbers grow? Because the growing of these numbers, the growing of these coefficients, is the crucial thing that will tell me what's the nature of this perturbative series. Now, it turns out that these guys also diverge factorially. So they diverge factorially. And they actually diverge for a fixed lambda as 2g factorial times a space time, so a is t of lambda to the minus 2g. So this is the typical behavior of these quantities. So you see that string perturbation theory is also giving the same problems that you found in quantum mechanics, in the sense that if you want to evaluate the string perturbation series, you are going to make you are going to have to do something about it, because it has this factorial which is going to kill any region of convergence for the series. And what is appearing here, this A instanton, depends on lambda, you see, is precisely the function that appears here. So the appearance, this divergence here, is related to this non-perturbative effect here, in the same way that this morning we were seeing that the divergence of the coefficients in standard quantum mechanics was related to the appearance of these instanton corrections. So, well, notice that here there is a 2g factorial, not a g factorial, and there has been a lot of fuss about it. Well, this is not as important. Essentially, it's due to the fact that this series is actually an even series in G-string. Eh? But the perturbative, the non-perturbative effect, the leading non-perturbative effect is not in G-string square. Eh? It's in G-string. Okay? So this actually was a little bit puzzling, and one of the reasons, one of the things that people discussed in the early days of this non-perturbative effect is that also the series was in G-string square, essentially in G-string square, because you have always even powers. The non-perturbative effect still was involving 1 over G-string and not 1 over G-string square. So in a sense, these are these non-perturbative effects are larger than what you would expect, okay? And this is one of the reasons that Polchinski was mentioning that you need some sort of different kind of object in string theory, which was given bigger instanton effects than what you would expect, say, in quantum mechanics. Because, in a sense, you have to, this has to go with the square root of the effective coupling that appears in this series. Okay? But this is what you find. And this has been verified in many examples, from examples in non-critical strings, and now we can, as I will explain, in theories with a large n-dual, we can actually check this with a lot of accuracy. And you see that conceptually it's not very different from what we saw before. Now the question, I mean, also this is not very different from what happens in quantum mechanics. No, this is raising a very deep problem. And the problem is that if you want to make sense of a string theory, at some point you have to make sense of this series, right? In quantum mechanics, you have the Schrodinger equation, which saves the day for you. But in string theory, we don't have all the time, you know, we don't have in all cases something like the Schrodinger equation, and so you really have to make sense of this thing. And one of the virtues of AdS-CFT is that a priori, it gives you an a priori answer that this, you can make sense of this by using a gauge theory. And this is what we are going to explore also in these lectures. Now, let me make a final comment on the relation to string theory. And also, I have here given you two different kinds of non-perturbative effects. It turns out that in some special cases, these things can be unified in a single description. And this is when you discuss tie to A superstring theory. So in tie to A superstring, you can go to M theory. And in M theory, both Wolsey instantons and space-time instantons are manifestations of membrane instantons. So here, there is a unifying notion of membrane instanton. And I think this was observed first by Becker, and Strominger, shortly after the introduction of M theory. So what is going on? Well, remember that this is a theory in 10 dimensions, and this is a theory in 11 dimensions. Now, tie to A theory has two couplings, as any string theory. It has the string length and the string coupling constant. In M theory, you really have one single coupling, which is the Planck length. But when you go to 10 dimensions, you have to introduce another quantity, which is the radius of the 11th dimension. Okay? So now you have one single coupling coming from the M theory, plus one radius that comes from the compactification to the dimensions, and with these two quantities, you make up these two quantities by a relationship that you can find already by working out the supergravity, and these are these famous equations that you can find in many books. For example, in Thomas Ortin's book on deep brain strings, gravity and strings, there is a very detailed derivation. So this is the relationship between the single coupling constant of M theory and the radius of compactification to the two parameters of type 2A superstring. Now, how do we see these two effects coming from a single source? Okay, now imagine that you are in 11 dimensions. So you are in M theory in 11 dimensions. And now you want to understand this in terms of some topological object. Now, there is something in M theory which is called the M2 brain, which is a three-dimensional object. So here, let me imagine that I have a some object in three dimensions, with three dimensions, inside 11 dimensions, that a membrane can wrap in some way. Let me call this M. Now, what is the kind of non-perturbative effect that you, what is the strength of a non-perturbative effect that you would expect for a three-dimensional object? Well, you see here that if you have a two-dimensional object, the intrinsic scale of a three-dimensional object is going to be its area divided by the length of the string, right? Now, I shouldn't have erased this. Let me write it like that. In three dimensions, what you would expect is something. You have a membrane like this, you would expect a non-perturbative effect, which weight is going to be the volume of this guy, which is a three-dimensional cycle, measured in units of the Planck length LP to the cube. Okay? So this is the typical weight of a membrane instanton in theory. But now when you go to 10 dimensions, you have two choices. Remember, if you go to two dimensions, you have to do a compactification of a cycle of radius R11, and then you have two choices. The three cycle can actually wrap this extra dimension, and then what you get in 10 dimensions is a two-dimensional object. So it can happen that this M splits into a Riemann surface of genus G plus a third dimension wrapping the circle. Or you can have that the three cycle goes directly to the 10-dimensional space without wrapping the extra direction. So you get something here which is still three-dimensional. So let me call it, S. I think it's the opposite notation to my notes, but that's fine. Okay, so what happens then? Now we can use these relationships that I got here. And then we see that when you wrap the compactification in this situation, the volume of M will be proportional to the volume of this Riemann surface in the two-dimensional setting times R11. While here, since you are not wrapping the 11 dimension, the volume factor doesn't involve R11 and you just have volume of S. So you see now that you're in the first situation, we'll recover these formulas in a moment, what you get is exponential of minus volume of sigma G times R11 divided by LP to the cube, okay? But now, if we use this relationship here, you see that, erase this as well, you see that we get exponential of minus the volume of sigma g, R11 is g string times ls, and lp to the cube is g string ls to the cube. So what we get is exponential of minus volume of sigma g times ls squared. And this is the size of a non-perturbative effect coming from a Wall City instanton in type 2A. Now, if we don't wrap, the 11 dimension, what you will get here is just simply volume of S divided by LP to the cube, which is, notice, LS to the cube divided by GST. So you see that we got the typical 1 over GST dependence that I was telling you is typical of a non-perturbative in the string coupling constant. And then the space-time instanton action comes from an intrinsically three-dimensional object. So what we expect from this picture is that when there is an M theory behind our superstring theory, the effects that are due, the non-perturbative effects in the string coupling constant are actually induced by a three-dimensional object in M theory. This is what we would expect. And notice that from the point of view of M theory, you cannot really distinguish these two objects. They are just different geometric types of membranes in 11 dimensions. The fact that this membrane is wrapping this direction or not is just a topological feature, but there is nothing to distinguish them. You have to take them, you have to take it on equal footing, right? So in a sense, M theory doesn't make a fundamental distinction between space-time instantons and Wall City instantons. It's only when you go to type 2A theory that you get such a picture. Of course, when an M2 brain descends to a three-dimensional object in string theory, we know that this has to be interpreted as a D2 brain. And this makes contact with the observation of Polchinski that in type 2A theory, you will see this three-dimensional object of M theory as a 2D brain, okay? So this is a 2D brain effect. So this finishes a little bit my quick review of non-perturbative effects from quantum mechanics to M theory in one single strike. So are there any questions? Sorry? Yeah, five brains would actually lead to this effect in which you have E string square. So these five brains will give you another type of non-perturbative effect, which is actually not seen in the example I want to consider. But you would get also a different type of effect, which now you will have here square. That's why I was mentioning at the very beginning that I'm not really being exhaustive with respect to all possible non-perturbative effects. And let me point out something which I think is important. Now, when people talk about non-perturbative effect, they always want to find a semi-classical realization of these effects. Now, when we talk about instanton quantum mechanics, we want to think about them as saddle point solutions to the path integral. Here, we are thinking about this, for example, as quartz instantons in a nonlinear sigma model. Here, we are looking at this in terms of membrane. So we are thinking always as a sort of extra topological sector that leads to these objects. But it has to be clear, I hope it's clear, and if not, I'm saying it now, that in principle you can have a non-perturbative effect which is not associated to any semi-classical effect. And for example, in quantum field theory, there's a type of non-perturbative effects known as renormalons, which are not a priori coming from extra saddle points in the path integral. They are really coming from strong quantum fluctuations, or they have some sort of diagrammatic origin, but it's not clear at all that they can be associated in general to a semi-classical object. Another, what we will see, and I think this is something that you can really see in ADS-CFT, is that things which in string theory are coming from saddle points, in field theory are not coming from saddle points. They are actually due to strong quantum fluctuations. So sometimes these effects are emergent. These number of effects are emergent. They are not really associated to a saddle point. You cannot say, oh, yeah, this exponential comes from this particular saddle point configuration. No, the path integral can do crazy things. And sometimes quantum fluctuations around the vacuum can lead to something which is exponentially small and is non-analytic. So here, you know, we are very semi-classical. We're all semi-classical. And then we always try to fit our intuition, to physical intuition, to semi-classical objects. But quantum theories do crazy things, and sometimes you will find non-perturbative effects which are not due to semi-classical descriptions. So in string theory, we are lucky because supersymmetry tames the quantum fluctuations for us, and then we can more or less associate semi-classical objects to all these configurations, to all these effects, okay? Okay, so if there are no more questions, I want to get into the details, so I'm going to focus on one example, okay? So as I said, I don't want to make a general theory of non-perturbative phasing string theory. This is probably very difficult, and I guess it's much more useful to see how all these things can be made concrete in the context of a single important example. Okay? And this is the example of ABJN theory, which is a gauge theory with a known large chain dual, where all these things can be made concrete and you can calculate them. Okay? And then we will learn some new things about them. In particular, what we will learn is that M theory is extremely powerful. And essentially, all the story that I told you about perturbative divergence series and so on is only true in tight way superstring theory. In tight way superstring theory, you are stuck with these expansions. But actually, what we will see is that M theory essentially gives us back converging objects and gives us back objects which are much more powerful, much nicer analytic structures. So in a sense, the genus expansion is really an artifact of tight way theory. In M theory, there shouldn't be expansions. There should be only well-defined objects that then you expand asymptotically if you want, and you can make contact with tight way superstring theory. But in M theory, you are able to overcome all these problems of divergence. And I hope I will be able to show you that this is the case, okay, with concrete examples. Okay, are there any questions? Well, tight way B is a very different world, right? I mean, you have S duality and the coupling constant and so on. So there I would expect, of course you also have instanton FS in tight way B, right? And people have studied it. But I don't have anything concrete to say about tight way B. I mean, of course, you know, you will have these sort of expansions there, but since you have S duality, you will have extra constraints on this asymptotic expansion. This has been studied by Asoxen, for example, recently, how S-duality puts constraints on this sort of asymptotic expansion and so on. But I'm not going to tell you anything concrete about that. This is a general story, however. Okay, so then let's come back to examples. And then what I'm going to do is a very quick review of ABAN theory. Probably quicker but I have given lectures on ABJN theory and I have put them on the archive, so if you want to learn about the details, I refer you to my lectures on ABJN theory. But let me just give you some summary of what is ABJN theory, where ABJN stands from Aharoni, Berman, Jafferies, and Maldacena. Okay? Okay, so this is a gauge theory. But it's not a gauge theory based on the Jean-Mills action. It's a gauge theory based on the Chern-Simons action in three dimensions. So just in case you are not familiar with it, the Chern-Simons functional of a gauge connection in three dimensions can be written as trace of A with dA. So this is a three-dimensional connection plus two-thirds of A cubed. And this is a very peculiar theory. It has a kinetic term which is of first order in derivatives, not of second order. So this gives a theory which is has really different flavor from Jean-Mills theory. And then it has a cubic interaction which is close but not identical to the one that you find in QCD. And this action is actually, this action leads famously, as Witten explained to us in 89, a topological field theory. So the quantum field theory based on this action gives you a theory which, in which the observables, like the partition function, for example, do not depend on the metric that you put on your manifold and so on. And in physical terms, you can think about this action as an action which has a huge group of symmetries. And then it's a very good starting point to construct conformal field theories. Because conformal field theories are not topological, but they should have a higher degree of symmetry than the standard theory. And actually, in three dimensions, this is the starting point for constructing conformal field theories. Now, in ABJN theory, what you have to do is to take this action and supersymmetrize it. And I will be very, I will give you kind of few details of this, mostly because I actually don't remember all the details about all these superfields and so on. I knew them at some point by heart, but now I have a little bit forgotten them. So you have to supersymmetrize the Chern-Simons action. And then you can add n equal 2 matter in three dimensions, so all this is in three dimensions. And then you construct supersymmetric versions of Chern-Simons theory, which involve a supersymmetric version of this multiplet. So this just involves the n equal to vector multiplet. And then you have the n equal to matter, like chiral multiples and so on. Okay? Now, this doesn't give you ABGN theory. In order to get ABGN theory, you have to do something slightly more complicated. So you have to take two different Chern-Simons theories, and I will represent them with nodes. So each of these nodes is a Chern-Simons multiplet with gauge group UN. So let me, you want to call it UN1, and then UN2. Now, in Chern-Simons action, as it's causing Jan Mills, has a coupling, which is usually written like K. And actually, in order for the theory to be well-defined, you need this guy to be an integer. Now, the reason is that if this guy is not an integer, this action is not invariant. The path integral is not invariant under global gauge transformations. So this is a peculiar gauge theory because it has a coupling constant, but the coupling constant is quantized. But this is also very good if you want to have a conformal field theory, because in a conformal field theory, you know, the coupling shouldn't run. Now, you have a coupling that, for non-perturbative reasons, has to be an integer. It's going to be very hard that it runs, because it cannot run. It has to jump. Has to jump, and then, you know, essentially, this means that at the end, it won't move. So this is a very good starting point, then. And I will actually have here a Chern-Simons theory whose action with a gauge group UN with coupling K, and here I'm going to take the opposite coupling minus K. I can take negative couplings, this is not a big deal. Now, apart from the fact that this is quantized, in perturbation theory, you will never see that this guy is quantized. And then you can do perturbation theory in 1 over K. So if you want G Jan Mills square is essentially 1 over K, you can do perturbation theory in 1 over K. If K is very large, you don't see this, you don't see the quantization, you just see a coupling, a weak coupling, and then you can do perturbation theory. Now, so you take two copies of these guys, and then you connect them by adding four bifundamental hypermultiplets. Which sometimes are called phi I 1/4. And then this theory has the property that it has superconformal invariants and actually has n equals 6 superconformal invariants, so half the maximal degrees of the maximum number of supercharges. And it's a very nice superconformal field theory. It's a superconformal field theory. And there have been at least 1,000 papers on this theory, so I cannot tell you all the details about it. But for us, it has two important properties. One property you already can see purely at the field theory level. Now, in this theory, the fields are going to be vector multiplets, which are in the adjoint representation of the gauge group, and then we have matter. But this matter is in the bifundamental representation. So since we have gauge group UN, you know, effectively, these are also fields in the adjoint representation. So here, all the fields are Hermitian matrices, Hermitian valued, and then you can do the standard tough expansion of this theory. You can do essentially the same tough expansion that for pure Jan Mills, and we know just by 1 over n counting that, for example, if you calculate the, you can now calculate the free energy of this theory as a function of n and k. And usually, in order to have a well-defined quantity with no infrared divergences, you decide to put the theory, so you take this ABGN theory, and you put it in a compact manifold in order to compute this quantity more in a better defined way. And I will actually put the theory in all this talk. I will put it in the three sphere, okay, which is the simplest choice. So I take this gauge theory. I put it in a compact manifold. This regulates for me infrared divergences. And I can compute its free energy, as you would do in, say, thermal field theory. In thermal field theory, you put the theory in R2 times S1, Here I put a theorem S3, and then the free energy is just given by the sum of vacuum diagrams. Right? All the vacuum, you know, loop diagrams with no external lines. Now, Toff told us already in the 70s that if I have a theory with two parameters, n and k, remember that k is essentially g square, is the inverse of g square. So here, I can do what Toff taught us a long time ago. I can actually choose another coupling, which is n over k in this case. And remember that this is equivalent to take n to g square Jan Mills. And what I can do is to reorganize my vacuum diagram. So my vacuum diagrams are going to be like this, right? Something like this. I can reorganize it according to Toft in a different way. So I can consider diagrams that go like n square, and they are given by planar diagrams, right? Something like that. So this, 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 and this. And then I will have also diagrams of one loop diagrams, so diagrams of genus one, in which I will have, you know, diagrams in which I have some twisted lines like this. Okay, well, this is really complicated to draw. But you will have diagrams like this, and so on. And then you have a full 1 over n expansion. So to summarize, I will have a full 1 over n expansion, which actually looks like this. And now, I did the expansion here in n, but I can do the expansion in whatever parameter which scales at like n, and then I will actually do my expansion just to match conventions in the literature in terms of a parameter, which I'm going to call 2 pi I over k. Now, here, as I said, since not remember that k in this tough expansion, n goes to infinity and k goes to infinity in such a way that lambda is fixed. So I can do the expansion in powers of n, or I can do the expansion in inverse powers of k. Yeah. All these are equivalent after multiplication by a factor of lambda. Okay? So this is just the way you do the 1 over n expansion. You can do it in any parameter which scales, which goes to infinity when n is large. Okay? So this is an expansion actually in k, right? Because, yes. So this is an expansion in 1 over k, which also grows to infinity in the same way as n. It grows at the same pace because the quotient has to be fixed, okay? So this is something that Toff told us, that we can reorganize whatever quantity we want in this way, and in particular, we can reorganize the free energy, which is the simplest quantity that you can compute in a quantum field theory, by just doing this rearrangement. And notice, of course, that this has the same structure that the genus expansion of a superstring theory, and this is at the heart of the AdS correspondence. Already formally, you see that this gives me the same type of quantity, okay? So this is the first thing that I wanted to mention, that this theory, you can do these calculations, and people have done perturbative calculations of this sort of quantities in the 1 over n expansion for ABGN theory, so this is something that can be done. A priori, it's a complicated quantum physics calculation, but it can be done. Now, this theory then has a 1 over n expansion, in particular, it looks like this, and it was already in the original paper by Maldacena in 1988, it was already noticed that there should be a large chain dual for this theory. Now, actually, this worked the other way around. I mean, this is not like n equal 4 super Jan Mills. When Maldacena postulated the large chain dual to this theory, the theory itself, the Gauss theory itself, has not been constructed. So this was constructed later on because this, also I didn't mention here, this is a theory of M2 brains proving a singularity in C4 mod ZK. This I'm not going to use, but it's the basis for this large chain conjecture of Maldacena. So let me, instead of deriving for you how this goes, I mean, this was postulated by Maldacena based on the standard near horizon analysis and so on. Let me explain you what is the dual and how this duality works. This is important for the calculations that follow. So what is this large n dual? Well, the first interesting thing to notice is that in contrast to n equal 4 super young Mills, where you have a tie to B dual, here you have actually, originally you have an M theory dual. And you have an M theory dual and a tie to A dual. But this interplay between these two ways of looking at this duality will be also crucial in what follows. Now let me first write an equal 4 dual, sorry, M theory dual. So to do this, you have to consider M theory on an even dimensional manifold, which is given by ADS4 times S7 mod ZK. So this is the four-dimensional residual space, and this is S7, and you have here a quotient of this. This is a smooth quotient, it's not an orbifold, right? Because this is like the three-dimensional version of a Lens space. So if you realize the seven sphere as Z1 square plus ZA Z4 square equal to 1, then the action is just e to the 2 pi I over k zi, where I goes from 1 to 4. So this is a background of 11-dimensional supergravity, and it has a metric, which is a product metric, actually, up to a factor of 1/4. And very importantly here, there is a single scale length in the n-theory dual, which is the radius of the universe. This is the size of the universe, the radius of ADS4, and it's also the radius of S7 up to a factor of 1/2. So to be precise, you have this sort of thing. Okay, sorry, to erase this. Plus ds square of F7, what is that, k? And on top of that, you have also n units of G flux. So remember that in supergravity, in 11-dimensional supergravity, which is the large distance limit of M theory, there is like a three-form field, and then it's four-form field strength can have a flux through ADS4. So you have n units of flux. And then you see that here we have already the two parameters that correspond to the gauge theory dual. We have a k here, which is in the quotient of F7, and we have the n units of flux here. And this corresponds to the rank of the gauge group here and to the coupling constant here. So this k is here, okay? So this is what you have in this side, and if you actually solve the equations of motion, you actually notice that n fixes this size. Remember that M theory, you have only one length, which is the Planck length, and we have this relationship here, which tells me that when n is large, L over LP is large, okay? So this is the, yes? I don't hear you, sorry. Plugs. Yes, it's in the four dimensions of ADS4, right? Yeah, you have a four form, so you have to integrate over a four dimensional space. So. So this is the flux of DC. I don't know, sometimes people call it G or whatever. So this is a fourth form, okay? Okay, very good. So now the question is the following. What does it mean? Now, if you take this at face value, what does it mean? Well, this actually is very interesting from the point of view of the gauge theory and the theory, because you see, here there is a single parameter in this theory, in this M theory dual. As I told you, there is a single parameter, really. I mean, it's L over L Planck. And K is a geometric parameter. So here you can think about L over LP. And then when L over LP is very large, this is the regime. This is very important. This is the regime of large scales. So this is where the size of your universe is much larger than the Planck length. And this is precisely where semi-classical gravity works. So if we have a universe whose size is much bigger than the Planck size, we expect that doing general relativity, in this case, 11-dimensional supergravity, which is the largest scale distance of M theory, will work. Okay? Now, this, from the point of view of the Gauss theory, is a very interesting limit. Because here, if L over L Planck is very large, what we have is that N is very large. But K is fixed. So this is a limit in which the coupling constant has to be fixed, maybe to some value 1, 2, or 3, whatever you want, and then N is very large. So this is not like the standard tough limit. This is very important. In the standard tough limit, you take N very large, K very large, and N over K is fixed. Here is not the case. K has to be fixed, and then N is very large. So in particular, for example, if K is of order 1, this means that in this regime, from the point of view of the tough coupling, you are always a strong coupling. Because lambda is going to be very large, say, if K is equal to 1 or 2. Here, in this point of view, K can be any number you want, but you don't have to scale it. You have to really face the fact that you have to deal with this theory when K is equal to 1 or 2. In M theory, you are always in the strongly coupled limit of the field theory. But if you want to make contact with semi-classical gravity, then N has to be very large. So this means, in a sense, that you are thinking about the Gauss theory as a theory with fixed coupling constants, and you are taking the number of gluons, if you want, and superponents of the gluons to be very large. So this is more like a thermodynamic limit of the Gauss theory. It's not really, it's more like a thermodynamic limit, and it's not really a tough limit a priori. We will be able to make contact with the tough limit, a priori it's not a tough limit, and I will call this the M theory regime or the M theory expansion. Now, notice that here the natural expansion parameter here is LP over L. This is the natural small parameter here. So in the gravity theory, what you should expect is that when this parameter is very large, the leading order is captured by 11-dimensional supergravity, and then you will have corrections coming from loop corrections in supergravity. From the point of view of the Gauss theory, this means that you have to keep K fixed, and then you have to take N very large and do an expansion in 1 over N when where K is fixed, which is different from the tough expansion that tough tells us to do. Actually, from the point of view of the diagrammatics, I don't know of any argument that shows that this type of limit is actually well-defined. It's just a very peculiar property of this type of theories. The tough limit is a universal property of any Gauss theory in which the fields live in the Hermitian, take values in the Hermitian matrix. This M theory limit is a very peculiar limit of this type of theory. I don't think it's a universal feature of any quantum field theory a priori. It's just the existence of this M theory dual which guarantees you that there should be some sense in which this expansion is actually appropriate. But from the point of view of diagrammatics, you don't understand how this is going to work because actually, Toft invented this type of scaling precisely to make sure that diagrammatics was going to work and we were going to be able to reorganize the perturbation theory in good powers of N. So this is actually a very interesting property of this theory. Now, when L is of, or say, when L over LP is of order 1, right, what we have is a universe which is Planck size, the size of your universe of Planck size. And this, from the point of view of the Gauss theory, is precisely the regime in which N is small, but K is still fixed. So it's still a strong coupling regime of the Gauss theory, but it's a Gauss theory with few degrees of freedom. Okay, so this is just to understand a little bit the dictionary and what are the regions where we want to look at. And as usual in the AdS ICTP correspondence, you see that the region where the supergravity is easy is the region where we have L over LP is very large, but then we have to really look at this Gauss theory in this sort of thermodynamic limit. So what I'm going to do tomorrow is I'm going to start by looking at the tie two version of this because as it was already known to the people doing supergravity, this background has a tie two A version, and in this tie two A version, we'll be able to make contact with the genus expansion of Toft, okay? But we'll see that there are two actually, in this theory, there are two stories. There is the M theory story, and then there is the tight 2A story. And part of the richness of this large N duality, in contrast to N equal 4 super Jarmis, is how you go back and forth between the M theory description and tight 2A theory description. And this is what we're going to exploit in the next tomorrow. Okay? Thank you.